नमस्ते, आई वुड लाइक टू वेलकम यू ऑल फॉर टुडे सेशन। टुडे वी विल बी डीलिंग विद एक्सिपिएंट्स इन डोसेज फॉर्म्स। सो मूविंग ऑन टू द डेफिनेशन ऑफ एक्सिपिएंट्स, इट इज डिराइव्ड फ्रॉम द लैटिन वर्ड एक्सिपियर व्हिच मीन्स टू एक्सेप्ट और अदर दैन। फार्मास्यूटिकल एक्सिपिएंट्स आर एवरीथिंग अदर दैन द एक्टिव फार्मास्यूटिकल इन्ग्रीडियंट्स, that is API, that have been appropriately evaluated for safety and intentionally included in drug delivery system. According to IPEC, excipients are those products which have slight or no action and is intended to be added in the formulation to make it more effective. So why should we add excipients? As per API, it's to be added when the handling is difficult or impossible, and when accurate drug dosing is not possible. API may cause local irritation or injury in some cases, or if API can have unpleasant organoleptic properties, or API can be degraded at the site of action. Excipient properties are as enumerated follows. That is, it should be stable and it should be reproducible. So there should not be any unwished interaction with the drug. That is, it should not react with effect. It should be pharmacologically inert. It should have the desired functionality. And it should be cost effective also. So moving on to the role of excipients. Excipients have different roles in a formulation. Major ones are, it can aid in processing of the drug delivery system during its manufacture. It protects, support or enhance stability, bioavailability or patient acceptability. It assists in product identification and enhance any attribute of the overall safety. It assists in the effectiveness and or delivery of the drug in use. It assists in maintaining the integrity of the drug process during the storage. So classification of excipients are done on the basis of routes of drug administration, on the basis of its origin and on the basis of its function. Based on the route of drug administration, it is mainly classified into oral excipients, which may be binders or flavors, and topical excipients, which may be bases. It is classified into inorganic chemicals or organic chemicals. So under inorganic chemicals, we have calcium phosphates, calcium carbonate, calcium sulfate, halides and metallic oxide. And under organic chemicals, we have carbohydrates, starch, cellulose and proteins. By function, it is classified into fillers and diluents, binders, coatings, flavoring agents, disintegrants, colorants, lubricants, preservatives and antiadherents. So excipients in different dosage forms are explained now. So in solid dosage form, we have binders, diluents, disintegrants, lubricants, antiadhesives, glidants and coloring agents. And in semi-solid dosage form, we have bases, preservatives, antioxidants and chelating agents. And in liquid dosage forms, we have vehicle microbial agents, antioxidants, sweetening agents, flavoring agents, suspending agents and preservatives. So moving on to binders. Binders impart cohesiveness. Some substances which are available in the crystalline form can be compressed directly by majority of the drugs and will have to be converted to granules before compression. The agents which are used during granulation to impart cohesiveness to the powdered substances are known as binders. They keep the tablet intact after compression. So various commonly used binders are starch, acacia, tragacanth, gelatin, glucose, lactose, sucrose, methyl cellulose, etc. In some formulations, binders are used in dry form, whereas in others they are used as liquids by dissolving them in a suitable solvent like water, alcohol, or a mixture of these two. The proportion of binding agents has to vary from product. The tablets which are required to keep intact for a long time, like lozenges and implants, need high percentage of binders, whereas tablets which should disintegrate in a short time need low proportion of binders. Next one is diluents. Increases the bulk of a dosage form and it helps in proper dose fixation. When the quantity of is very small and it is not practicable to compress such small amount in the form of a tablet, then inert substances which are added to increase bulk of the powder to be easily compressed are known as diluents. Various diluents used are lactose, sodium chloride, starch, powdered sucrose, mannitol, calcium carbonate, calcium sulfate, and calcium phosphate. Next one is disintegrating agents. So it helps in disintegration or breaking down, facilitates dissolution. Disintegrating agents or disintegrators are the substances or a mixture of substances which are added to tablets to facilitate their disintegration or breaking apart into smaller pieces in GIT after administration, thus facilitating dissolution. Generally, two types of disintegrating agents are used. First one is substances which swell up when they come in contact with moisture, and the second one is substances which react with effervescence when they come in contact with moisture. The most popular and commonly used disintegrating agents of first type are maize starch and potato starch. These starches have affinity for water and they swell up when they come in contact with water, thus breaking the tablet apart. The other disintegrating agents include vegum, methyl cellulose, agar, bentonite, carboxymethyl cellulose, and citrus pulp. Some manufacturers use sodium lauryl sulfate along with starch as disintegrating agents. This produces better wetting of the granules and it results in faster dissolution rate of the drugs. The second type of disintegrating agents includes a combination of sodium bicarbonate, citric acid, and tartaric acid. So when this combination comes in contact with moisture present in the stomach, it produces effervescence, thus disintegrating the tablet. Generally, disintegrating agents are added in two portions. The major part is incorporated to the powders before granulation, and the other is mixed with the dried granules along with the lubricants. Disintegrators added in this manner serves two purposes. The disintegrant added after granulation breaks the tablet apart into granules, and the portion is added before granulation breaks the granules into fine particles, thus facilitating the dissolution of drugs. The disintegration time of a tablet depends upon many factors, that is, quantities of diluents, binders, lubricants, tablet hardness, size of granules and coatings, etc. Lubricants. Reducing the friction during tablet ejection between tablet walls and dye cavity walls, and delays wear and tear of the which are added to granules before compression to improve the flow from the hoop dye cavity by reducing inter-particle friction, and to prevent adhesion of the powder to the surface of the dyes and punches, thus reducing wear and tear of dies and punches. And it helps to facilitate the ejection of the tablet from the die cavity after compression. So commonly used lubricants are magnesium stearate, calcium stearate, stearic acid and talc. Other materials such as cocoa butter, hydrogenated vegetable oil, liquid paraffin, hard paraffin, waxes and wax-like materials may also be used as lubricants to prevent adhesiveness to the surface of dies and punches. Next one is anti-adhesives. So it prevents adhesion of the tablet granules to the punches. Some of the examples are stearic acid, talc, starch, etc. Next one is glidants. It promotes flow of granules by forming a round structure of the particle and it reduces the friction between the particles. And some of the examples are talc and cornstarch. Next, coloring agents. Coloring agents are used to impart elegance to the tablets. Sometimes they are also used. Only the approved colors are used. These colors may be added either in the mixed powders before granulation or the chemicals used for making the granules. The latter procedure gives more uniform color. Next one is flavoring agent. Generally, flavors are added to lozenges, chewable tablets and effervescence tablets. Volatile oils, volatile substance and fruit flavors are used for this purpose. The volatile substances are dissolved in a suitable organic solvent and it is sprayed over the granules before compression. Fruit flavors and spray-dried beadlets are incorporated to the mixed powder before granulation. So it masks any unpleasant taste or odor, improves patient compliance, it becomes more palatable. Flavoring agents are mainly classified into two types, that is natural. Under natural, we have fruit extracts, cardamom, orange and peppermint. And under artificial, we have allyl benzoate and allyl caprate. And the flavors are usually sprayed over granules before compression. Next one is sweetening agents. Sweetening agents are added to the tablets which are required to be dissolved in the buccal cavity. The basis for their example, mannitol, lactose, sucrose, etc. They impart sweetness of varying degree. The additional sweetness may be imparted by including additional quantity of sucrose and artificial sweetening agents like cyclamates and saccharin. By the use of cyclamates and saccharin have been banned, therefore sugars can be included to impart an acceptable taste. Forms and chewable medications, and it is of two types, that is mainly caloric, which is commonly advised for non-diabetics, and non-calorics, mainly for diabetics. Some of the examples are glucose, etc. So moving on to the next one, that is preservatives. Preservatives are added to prevent contamination or deterioration by bacteria or fungi, and it is mainly used only in multiple dose products. Some of the examples are benzoic acid, ethyl paraben, propyl paraben, sodium benzoate, etc. So preservative is a substance which is added to pharmaceutical formulation to prevent or inhibit the growth of microorganism in the preparation. They are added to all formulations which are to hold for longer periods of time and the ingredients of which support microbial growth. The emulsions and suspensions containing water and carbohydrates as emulsifying and suspending agents respectively must be suitably preserved Because water and carbohydrates provide very good medium for the multiplication of bacteria and molds. Further, the parenteral preparations packed in multi-dose containers must contain a preservative to check the growth of microorganisms which may have accidentally entered the container during the withdrawal of the drug. A preservative is unnecessary in multi-dose containers prepared by heating with bactericide because they already contain a lethal substance, nor they are necessary in preparations which contain medicament bactericidal properties. So, choice of a preservative. The preservative selected should have the following properties, that is, it should be effective against a wide range of microorganisms. It should be compatible with other ingredients of the formulations, and it should be soluble in aqueous phase when used in emulsions. It should be non-toxic, it should be free from odor and color, and it should preserve the preparations and remain stable for the shelf life of the product. No single preservative possesses all the qualities, therefore it becomes necessary to use combination of preservatives to prevent the growth of microorganisms. The most commonly used preservatives are as follows. So 0.1 to 0.2%, salicylic acid 0.1%, phenol 0.2 to 0.5%, chlorocresol 0.05 to 0.1%, alcohol 15 to 20%, chlorobutanol 0.5%, phenyl mercuric nitrate 0.002 to 0.005%, sorbic acid and its salts 0.05 to 0.2%, benzalkonium chloride 0.002%, methyl paraben and propyl paraben 0.1% to 0.2%. Next one, that is antioxidants. An antioxidant is a substance which is added to pharmaceutical formulation to prevent the oxidative degradation of the drug. The antioxidants have great affinity for oxygen, and when they are added to formulation, they cause other oxygen sensitive drugs. An ideal antioxidant should be stable and effective against a wide range of pH, should be colorless, non-toxic, non-irritant, thermostable and compatible with formulations, ingredients and packaging material. Some of the commonly used antioxidants are sodium bisulfite, sodium metabisulfite, sodium thiosulfate, ascorbic acid, ascorbyl palmitate hydroquinone, propylgalate, butylated hydroxytoluene and butylated hydroxyanisole and tocopherols. Next one is humectants. So it's mainly used mainly in dosage forms for external applications, and it prevents drying of the product after application to the skin. Prevents drying of the product from the container after first opening also, and prevents cap locking caused by condensation onto neck of the container. Some of the examples include propylene glycol, glycerol, etc. Moving on to granulating agents. So these agents convert primary powder particles to larger particles or granules, and the quantity are less capping or poor adhesion and more to hard tablets, delayed disintegration. That is mainly done while preparing hard tablets in order to delay the disintegration. And some of the examples are water, mucilages of acacia and liquid glucose. Next one is flocculating agent. It is chiefly used in suspensions and it for a longer duration. For example, sodium lauryl sulfate is an example of flocculating agent. When formulating suspensions, it must be ensured that the particles are well dispersed in the vehicle. The dispersion Conversion can which will act by reducing the interfacial tension. For example, if surfactants with negative charges are absorbed on particles, it prevents or minimizes flocculation in the presence of positive ions because of natural repulsion of like charges. Sulfate and sodium dioctyl sulfosuccinate are examples of this type of surfactants. Non-ionic surfactants also usually assume a negative charge in solution, thereby acts as effective flocculating agents. It is generally non-ionic surfactants are used for dispersing the insoluble particles. Tweens, spans and carboaxes are frequently used in this manner. Colloids can also be used as flocculating agents. They differ from surfactants in that they don't reduce the interfacial tension. Their solutions differ in viscosity and are used in higher concentration than surfactants. So moving on to the concept of excipients in Ayurveda, some of the commonly used binding agents are guda. In case of some of the examples are Manibhadra guda, Modaka, etc. And Guggulu can act as a binding agent, and one of the examples is Chandraprabhavati, Sita also in case of Chandraprabhavati. And some of the coloring agents are Manjishta, and the example is the addition of Manjishta in case of Taila Murchana, of Haridra during Grida Murchana, and addition of Laksha in preparation of Laksha Rasa. And some of the flavoring agents, Elatvak, Patra, Lavanga, Naga Keshara, etc., which are commonly added for Chyavanaprasha, Avaleha, Haridra, Ganda, etc. as flavoring agents. Some of the sweetening agents are Sita, Guda, Madhu, which are commonly added for Avaleha, Asavarishta, Vati, etc. as sweetening agents. And some of the preservatives are Guda. And us have self-generated alcohol which acts as a preservative by itself. And what are the rules to be followed when we are considering any excipients? So Prevention of Food Adulteration Act 1954 and Bureau of Indian Standards Act, that is BIS Act 1986, Drug and Cosmetic Act 1940 and Rules 1945 tells him to be followed when we are considering excipients to be added in any drugs or in cosmetics. So as per these rules in Ayurveda, Siddha and Unani drugs with the following conditions, namely, the excipients shall be used in permissible limits as prescribed in the Indian Pharmacopoeia or Prevention of Food Adulteration Act 1954 or Food Product Order or Bureau of Indian Standards Act 1986, and they shall comply with the respective quality specification, not exceeding any specified limits of usage therein, and except hydrogenated vegetable oil. And the second one is that only natural coloring agents as permitted under the Rule 26 of Food and Prevention Act, that is PFA rules, that is Prevention of Food Adulteration Rules 1955, will be used for ASU, that is Ayurveda, Siddha and Unani drugs, and additionally colors permitted under the Rule 127 of Drug and Cosmetic Act 1945 shall be used for proprietary ASU drugs as defined in Section 3 of Drug and Cosmetic Act 1940, not exceeding any specified limits of usage therein. Preservatives and coloring agents shall be mentioned on the label for the information of the consumer as required under Rule 161 of the Drugs and Rules 1945. And the additives used in various processes and formulations, formulating dosage forms, shall be mentioned clearly with in the application of the license, and the records of the same shall be maintained by the company. Manufacturers shall be responsible to ensure rationality, safety and quantity used of various excipients in the formulation. And if any excipients or additives or preservatives etc. referred in Indian Pharmacopoeia or Prevention of Food Adulteration Act 1954 or Food Product Order or Bureau of Indian Standard Act 1986 is deleted at a particular point of time, this will also be deleted simultaneously for the use. The licensing authority will keep in mind the above ADI, that is acceptable daily intake limits, while processing applications for grant or renewal of license of ASU products containing artificial sweeteners. So how safe are these excipients? We have to consider whether drug excipient interactions happens within the body or outside the body, and if there is any excipient to excipient interaction which is happening either outside the body or within the body. So what is drug excipient interaction? It's mainly physicochemical, and as it reduces stability, there will be adsorption of drug to excipient, and there may be a decrease in bioavailability or a different molecule which may cause the degradation of the product. And excipient to excipient interactions, this is common, like this is not that common, it's very rare, and they may have an implication on drug stability, drug release, therapeutic activity, and have a side effect profile. So concluding, even though excipients are claimed to be inert, they may have certain action or adverse reaction. The biological, chemical, and physical properties of the final product thus affect by the excipients chosen, their concentration, and the interaction with the API. The adaptation of modern techniques or methods to convert the Ayurvedic formulations without altering its therapeutic properties necessary to make them suitable for the present trends of newer drug delivery dosage forms. Thank you for your patient listening.